welcome for those who are worshiping with us for the first time. This is the third Sunday of Advent. Order of worship. Thank you. We're going to get started with the lighting of the Advent wreath, and I'd like to invite here up here. Watching you and something not working. There we go. All right. I invite the congregation to please stand. People of God, return. You are called to be God's own. For the mountains announce the good news. God comes in justice and peace to all who follow her ways. You are God's children.
Lord, be us one in Jesus Christ today and forever. Amen.
And there's a change in our program. The opening hymn will be hymn 61, found in your blue hymnal. Hymn 61, 6-1. because we are sorely hindered by our sins. Let your bountiful grace and mercy speedily help and deliver us through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, the honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Zephaniah. Sing aloud, O daughter Zion, shout, O Israel. Rejoice and exult with all your heart, O daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away the judgments against you. She has turned away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You shall fear disaster no more. On that day it shall be said to Jerusalem, do not fear, O Zion. Do not let your hands grow weak. The Lord your God is in your midst, a warrior who gives victory. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will renew you in his love. He will exult over you with loud singing as on a day of festival. I will remove disaster from you so that you will not bear reproach for it. I will deal with all your oppressors at that time. And I will save the lame and gather the outcast, and I will change their shame into praise and renown in all the earth. At that time, I will bring you home. At the time when I gather you, for I will make you renown and praise among all the peoples of the earth, when I restore your fortunes before your eyes, says the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
With thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sing aloud, O daughter of Zion, and shout, O Israel, rejoice and exult. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, rejoice, you brood of vipers. There is a lot going on in these readings. And at first glance, they can appear to almost contradict each other. We have that wonderful reading in Zephaniah that tells us to sing aloud, to rejoice. The Lord has taken away your judgments against you. She has turned away your enemies. A warrior God image that has come to save us. Undoubtedly, the people of Israel were looking for and longing for. And then we have that wonderful second reading from the letter to the Philippians. Rejoice in the Lord always. Rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone, for the Lord is near. And something I have a hard time swallowing: do not worry about anything, but in prayer and supplication, let your requests be known to God. So what does that have to do with this crazy guy out in the wilderness named John the Baptist? Did he take a right turn or a left turn and get off track? Is God doing something new? Perhaps. Perhaps not. I'm always struck by the image of John out there in the wilderness, and people going out to him, making a trek out into the wilds of the wilderness. Now, many of us in our wonderful modern day thing like to think of the wilderness and our wonderful retreat centers out in the wilderness, and everything is calm, quiet, and serene. But not so much in the times of John and Jesus. The wilderness was a harsh place, and you took a risk going out there. So here you have all these people willing to go out into the wilderness to see this guy, John. And they go out there and they trek out there with great expectations, having in their minds perhaps the readings from Zephaniah and all the readings of the prophets and people before him, of this longing for this Messiah, this new thing. Yet this old thing that God is doing, and he gets out there, and they get called a brood of vipers. I suspect they didn't laugh like you all. I suspect it was hard for them to hear, but perhaps necessary for them to hear. We need a wake-up call from time to time. The same things get lost over and over and over again. While these words may seem harsh, or maybe not as harsh as we think, and underlies, in a sense, love. First of all, I don't know how often you use the term brood of vipers. Maybe you do. But if you're unfamiliar with the term brood, and this is an important distinction, brood means children of, right? So in a sense, John wasn't saying, you're a viper. But in a sense, he was saying, you're children of vipers. And in a sense, at least the way I read it is, we are trapped in a system. A system that has gone on for way too long. Of greed and of violence, and is not the dream that God intended for this world. And in fact, our job, as our presiding bishop has reminded us, is to take this nightmare that we're living in and bring God's dream into fruition. And John didn't mince words. I think, you know, often, too often in Christianity, we put those wonderful niceties on. Now, don't get me wrong. I know I've been in church long enough to know that church people can be mean, too. But all too often, we don't call each other out.
in a good way, not in a mean-spirited way, but to help us be the best selves that we are called to be. That doesn't mean that you go around looking where people are going wrong. But what if we as Christians, as followers of Christ, had the boldness to ask the question, what then shall we do? I don't think the answer simply is come to church Sunday after Sunday and then go into the world and do whatever you please. In a sense, we are called to do and to be something different. I wonder if your people at work or your co-workers or people that you come and encounter with on a daily basis would know that you're a Christian. Would they be surprised that you're a Christian? Would you have to tell them, or would they simply know by your actions, by the way you carry yourself, by the way you encounter the world? Perhaps a good question for us to reflect on. And the reality of it is, no matter what your job is, or what you do, or who you are, there's an answer for you on how to live. And that's what these people were seeking. You had tax collectors and soldiers coming out. Now, these were people that were not the highest of society, in a sense, many would probably argue that they didn't deserve to be loved by God. You know how they are. It was all too common for tax collectors to exploit the system and to take more than what was required of them. And soldiers abuse their power all the time, getting a little bit on the side to supplement their income. And it's easy to look down at them, but, you know, maybe we need to look a little bit on ourselves. How much is our own society and capitalism dependent on greed? And how much do we perhaps benefit from that? Or on a system of violence that perpetuates itself over and over again. Yeah, so perhaps we're a little bit more like the soldiers than we would like to admit or be comfortable with. And how many of us are willing to give up a coat or food? I mean, after all, the need to seem so great, what difference would that make? And yet, here in today's lesson, we are called to be something different. Now, many of you may have a hard time hearing this as something you should rejoice about, especially with all the talk of winnowing forks and quenchable fire. And that's been used by many people in the Christian tradition to strike fear into people. You better get your life straight, or there will be unquenchable fire. But what if? I could be going out on a limb here, but what if God doesn't want us in the unquenchable fire? What if God wants those things that greed, that perhaps pride, for all those other things that keep us from being our best self, to be true children of Abraham, to be true children of God, to be followers of Christ, all those things that keep us from that, and for each of us, they're perhaps a little bit different. What if God wants us to throw that into the unquenchable fire? What if that's the chaff, the things that we don't need, that we think we want, that I think our lives are so dependent on. What if that is what is called to be thrown into the fire? And what if we can get to a point where we don't hold so tightly onto that? Just maybe. Maybe we rejoice about giving that stuff up. Maybe we voluntarily rejoice in the Lord always and sing aloud, O daughter of Zion, that we can release that and give that to God. Imagine what fruit we would bear. Imagine what the world would be like. Maybe, just maybe, we can rejoice in the Lord always. Amen.
Standing, let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in
one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made. Of one need in the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit as the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead, in the life of the world to come. Amen.
We continue with the prayers of the people. I invite your prayers for the following people on our prayer list. The daughter of, give thanksgiving for the birth, daughter of Noel and Brian Kennedy. We pray for Kim Lucas, Grace Crane, Peggy Ann Cohen, Christian Jones, Deshae Montgomery, Jen Knapp and family. Nancy, Cy, Fran, Jim Murphy, David Gucharski, Stephanie, Danielle, Montio, Liz, Riddle Hoover, Steve Parsons, Paula Amadeo, Lynn Mola, Debbie Hipp, Sarah Hamilton, Debbie Chandler Collier, and Andrew Rutledge.
And I invite your own prayers and petitions, either silently or aloud at this time. In joyful expectation of his coming to our aid, we pray to Jesus. Lord Jesus, do not delay. Give new courage to your people who trust in your love. By your coming, raise us to share in the joy of your kingdom on earth as in heaven, where you live and reign with the Father and the Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us humbly confess our sins to the Almighty God. Peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace.
couple of announcements. The first announcement, please notice a correction in your bulletin. That was, I will take the blame for this, I assume. I was incorrect on this. Actually, we'll be at St. Margaret's next Sunday, which is right up on Connecticut, north of the circle, 1830 Northwest. The time originally said 11:15, but it's actually at 10 o'clock. That's the carol service with Eucharist. Combined music programs and everything, I'm sure it'll be absolutely wonderful. There'll be one service at 10 o'clock, so you can sleep in a little bit and make your way over to St. Margaret's. We're also doing Christmas Eve with them. There'll be two services, both one at family service at 5, and the musical prelude will start at 10:30 with a service at 11 o'clock, again at St. Margaret's. Had a wonderful tacky Christmas party. Thank you for all those who attended. You all were very tacky. I appreciate it. And good food and good cheer and music and everything. So it was absolutely wonderful. Advent is not over yet, though. Our Advent series continues with St. Luke's and St. Margaret's at St. Margaret's this Wednesday. We have looked at women in the genealogy of Matthew. And the final one we will look at is Ruth. So if you want to know more about Ruth and why she made the genealogy of Jesus, please join us at the 6:30 early dinner, and then we'll start with the program around 7. When you get home, or shortly after you get home, sometime today, a letter will come in your email. It will be asking you to give for chairs. Some of you have said that you are willing to give chairs, but we're still kind of waiting on the check for that. So if you could help us do that, we want to give a deposit for these chairs, and we need some money to do that. Our goal is to get 200 chairs, and we've still got a ways to go in order to do that. So I'm going to say again, great Christmas gift. Much better than anything you will find on Amazon. So please, if you don't know what to get somebody or you don't want more stuff to clutter up your house, please have them buy a chair at $299. They're going to last us for as long as I'm around, hopefully, and maybe past that. So please do that. If you have any questions about that, you can see me afterwards. I don't see Steve or John here, please... please buy a chair in the future. And then lastly, we're getting to the point where Jesus is coming, but so is the end of our budget year as well. So if you have pledged and you have not fulfilled that pledge for 2018, we ask that you do that. We do a budget on that, so we took you on good faith that you were going to pay that, and we made certain decisions based on that. So if you could help fulfill that, that would make us feel a lot better. There's also a few of you who have not pledged for 2019, who pledged last year. So if you just haven't gotten around to that, again, we're about to do the budget for 2019, and we would appreciate having that input, knowing that we can count on you for 2019 as well. And if you're not sure you've done that, talk to Dave or myself, Dave, or raise your hand, or Carol over here as well, and we can find that out whether you pledged or not. Any other announcements? We continue with our offering, walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Thank you.
soul to you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is hard to give God thanks and praise.
All thanks and praise are yours at all times and in all places, our true and loving God. Through Jesus Christ, the eternal Word, the wisdom from on high by whom you created all things. You laid the foundations of the world and enclosed the sea when it burst out from the womb. You brought forth all creatures of the earth and gave breath to humankind. Wondrous are you, Holy One of us, in all you created, a sign of hope for our journey. So as a morning star sings your praises, we join the heavenly beings and all creation as we shout with joy. Supper, he took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is a new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection and ascension, longing for Christ coming in glory, presenting to you these gifts. Your earth is formed and human hands have made. We acclaim you, O Christ.
Dying, you restore our death. Rising, you restore our life. Christ Jesus, come in glory.
Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be to us the body and blood of your Christ. Grant that we, burning with your Spirit's power, may be a people of hope, justice, and love. Giver of life, draw us together in the body of Christ, and the fullness of time gather us to bless St. Thomas and all your people to the joy of our true eternal home. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, we worship you, our God and Creator, the voice of the living praise. Blessed are you, now and forever.
Amen.
So our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our
Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.